Let's consider the Fourier transform of this function over here, which is called the rectangular function, or rect, and it's defined as rect t by tau, which has the following shape. It has a height of 1, and the width of the pulse is tau. And of course, you can see it's not an infinite pulse, it's just a single pulse. And the width is tau, so the and it's zero centered on the y-axis, so it's tau 2 over here and minus tau over 2 on the other side. So to compute its Fourier transform, what we need to do is to just plug it into the formula. So the formula for the Fourier transform is this. It says x to omega is this integral over here, and what we see right away is that it only has a value between minus t over tau. Minus tau over 2 to tau over 2. And in that regime, it's 1. So this reduces to this simple integral over here, which is what I've shown over here. And if you were to evaluate this, then it's going to be just e to the minus j omega t by j omega, and the minus I put on top, and evaluate these two values, and that gives us this integral, this result over here. Now, remembering that the difference of two complex exponentials or complex conjugate exponentials is just the sine function divided by 2j, we can represent this as this value over here, sine omega tau by 2, and we're going to multiply numerator and denominator by tau by 2. We get this function, which you recognize as the sinc function, which is tau sinc omega tau by 2. And that's drawn over here. It's just the sinc function, except that what we have is that the value of a sinc function at 0 is 1, but we're pre-multiplying by tau, so this is going to be a height of tau at the frequency 0. And then the sinc function has zero crossings when omega tau by 2 equals k pi, or which means omega equals 2k pi by tau, 2k pi by tau. And so we are going to, we have the first zero crossing when k equals 1, which is 2 pi by tau, which is shown over here. This is the first zero crossing. There's another zero crossing over here. And the additional zero crossings over here and here and so on. And because of these zero crossings, we can do something clever, which is to find another function which actually has its peak over here, where it has a zero crossing. So it has a peak over here. And it'll have additional peaks as well over here, where this function has its zero crossings. And this function zero crossings will actually be aligned with the maximum of this function over here. So there will be zero over here, and so on. So if I were to draw this function, I'll just join these subs over here. So this is going to be a zero here. So this is what this function, the dash function like this. So it goes like that, and it goes up over here, and then it goes down to zero over here, and so on. So this sort of dash function I've shown over here is a function which is just slightly shifted. It's basically shifted by 2 pi by tau to the left of this value here. So its center frequency omega prime equals omega minus 2 pi by tau. And when you do this, this prime function, which is this dash function over here, is going to interfere very little because it doesn't have much energy in those locations where this rectangle function has energy. And so what you get is the intuition that it's possible for us to have two signals that are fairly close to each other in the frequency spectrum, yet they will not interfere with each other. And this is the basis for what's called orthogonal frequency division multiplexing, where you take a bunch of orthogonal frequencies which are fairly close to each other, and yet they don't interfere with each other because of this property, which comes right out of the analysis of the Fourier transform of a rectangular function.